Hi, I'm Cullen. I want to thank you for joining us today at Roots and Branches, where we are growing deeper in faith and reaching out in love. And if you found us online today, we're grateful that you did. I want to point you to the next best step for you to take as you engage in our community, and that is by clicking the links in this video description that'll take you to some upcoming ways you can get involved and to our website, rootsandbranchesmn.org, where you can click the contact us to find out more and to stay connected with all that's going on. And now, join me in prayer. God, we turn to you. Your arms are wide open to accept us wherever we're coming from, whatever we happen to think or believe. God, your love is steadfast and constant. And help us to open our hearts, to have an open disposition to whatever you have for us today, so that we can lead with love and discover hope in you. Amen.
Upon the waters, the great unknown, we're Laura. Welcome this morning. Of all the places that you could be and all the different worship areas that you could be, just letting you know that you're in the right place. Welcome. Last weekend, it warmed up a little bit. So some people in our community were able to get outside and do some sledding. So super exciting. About 25 people showed up for some community building and some outdoor physical activity, which has been, with this long winter, it's been doing pretty good. So look for opportunities in the future that we're hoping, now that things can open up a little bit more and people are getting some vaccines, that we can be a little bit safer being able to join together and community build in person and not just online and virtually. So keep an eye out for future events that will come out, and we're hoping to be able to see all your faces soon in person. One thing that we do need some more help on still is Little Blessings in Anoka. The second Sunday of every month, they need some volunteer opportunities. So check out the link in our description if you're able to sign up and help with that. That would be great. That is one thing with us being so isolated and not meeting in person. How can we show that we're here and open and hospitable to what the community needs? And so check out our website, check out email, or not, emails, we send out emails, but check out Facebook and all that too, of different ways that you can plug in if you feel that need to help in the community, or if you have a need in the community that needs help. Reach out to us. We're always looking for ways that we can plug in and help and put people in the right direction to be able to help our community and our towns, and being able to be hospitable to every need that we can fulfill out there. That's one thing with Roots and Branches that's super important, and it's super important to me, is making sure that we can fulfill needs that are out there, and fulfill needs that as easy as we can offer meals to somebody if they need help. We have that capability. If Little Blessings in Anoka needs some help, we can help with volunteers with that. If my friend is going through a hard time personally, but she can't really leave the house much, sending her a little video message every day with a little Bible passage just so her and I can discuss it is a ways of connecting. And I feel that Roots and Branches has really been a place where we can go for help, or go for if we want to be help. It's the conduit that gets us out in the world, and it brings the world to us. So again, super happy for have you joining us today, and God bless.
Welcome again to Roots and Branches. And today I want to welcome you back for part two of a series called From the Ashes, Stories of Redemption. Now, last Sunday, I shared some reflections on the book of Malachi, specifically about how God is in the business of bringing things back to life, especially when all hope seems lost. I talked about the image of a phoenix rising from the ashes and how powerful that metaphor is for our deepest longings as humans. And I also spoke about how this season of pandemic and racial reckoning and political unrest has us all feeling like it's time for something new to be born from the wreckage of this world. If you have a chance, I'd really like to encourage you to check out last week's message. It's still on Facebook and on YouTube. And I want to invite you back next week, when I'll be talking about Jesus' words for his enemies and what it has to teach us for a world as divided as ever. But today, we turn to the book of Job. Job is a strange book. I think I said that last week, too. Turns out the Bible's full of strange books. Anyway, I think probably one of the best known yet least understood books of the Bible is Job. On one hand, there's this very simple story, and on the other, it's a great poetic dive into the mystery of faith. The story is familiar enough. God and Satan are hanging out, and God says, "Have you ever noticed how righteous Job is?" And Satan replies, "Well, he's only righteous because you keep blessing him. You let me mess with his stuff and he'll turn on you in a heartbeat." And so God and Satan enter into this wager. And God says, "Let her rip. Just don't hurt him. Can't affect Job's physical health. Take everything else away." So Satan goes down to earth, and through a series of calamities, Satan wipes out Job's oxen and sheep and camels and children. And Job is noticeably upset by all this. Job 1 says that Job got to his feet ripped his robe, shaved his head, then fell to the ground and worshipped. Job said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, naked I will return there. The Lord has given, the Lord has taken. Bless the Lord's name." In all this, Job didn't sin or blame God. And through all this tragedy, Job doesn't sin. So, of course, Satan goes back up to God and says, please, can I hurt him? Can I please put Job through unnecessary physical suffering as well? And he must have given God the big puppy dog eyes, because God says, okay, do what you want to him, but don't kill him, okay? So God lets Satan infect Job with nasty sores all over his body, and so with nowhere to turn, Job goes to the place where they burn their trash outside the city and sits on a pile of ashes. He finds a piece of broken pottery, and he just sits there scratching the scabs and pus that cover his body. And after that, some friends come up to him and give him advice. I don't know if that's the right word for it. It's advice that doesn't make sense. And then God shows up, and some mysterious stuff happens. And finally, in the end, God restores Job's fortune and even doubles it. The end. Does that sound about right? Is that the story you've heard about the book of Job? Does it feel to you like something's missing? What else have you heard about the book of Job? And if you have insights about Job at all, add it to the comments section of this video today, whenever you might be watching. Well, here are some details that you might find helpful as we think through the book of Job. Most of the story I just told you happens in chapters 1 and 2, and then skipping all the way to the end at chapter 42. And the other 39 chapters are a bunch of poetry recounting the counsel of Job's friends and Job's reactions to that. And let me say that most of Job is this poetic reflection on the interaction between Job and his friends. So what exactly is going on here? Why do we recall the story but forget about the vast majority of the book? Why do we hear about Job's tragedy, then skip straight to the end when he gets everything back? Why is Job so tricky? Well, one reason might be that because we are dealing with more than one author here. From what scholars can tell, the easy part of Job, chapters 1 to 42, can be traced back to some very ancient sources. It's a folk story that was common throughout the ancient world across religions. It was kind of like an ancient Near Eastern fable, their version of Hansel and Gretel or the Three Billy Goats Gruff. The original narrative parts of Job were inherited by the Jewish tradition from older sources and then placed in their scripture along with the rest of it, which is commentary on the story that everybody knew. Chapters 1, 2, and 42 are not a story created by people who necessarily had our same understanding of who God is. And all that stuff in the middle is an attempt by later Jewish thinkers to make sense of it. I feel like this perspective is really helpful in thinking through the capricious, kind of a jerk God that we meet in chapters 1 and 2. When I flip through my Bible, this idea of God just doesn't fit. A God who will put a guy through hell just to prove a point? If God really is love, then we need to think critically about the version of God we meet in Job. Just because it's scripture doesn't mean we have to say all these things literally happened in history. No one was in God's throne room to see this conversation between God and Satan take place. So, either God miraculously dictated these words to someone, or this is just a description of one person's perspective on God as they try to think through the story of Job and the problem of human suffering. And I think that the way that this story has lasted throughout the ages, we can say it's inspired, whether it happened in history or not. Now, in your experience, which of these is more likely to have taken place? It's not that God can't make scripture in that divinely dictated way, but that's a big leap to make when Job doesn't even say that about itself. So let's see what Job actually says and make our conclusions about the point of it when we're all done. Because you see, even though we think the story of Job is the main point of the book, the bulk of the book, most of chapters 3 through 41, are actually a poetic commentary on the story that would have already been familiar to the first readers of Job. The original audience would have known the story part of Job already before even picking up this director's cut with the extra chapters. The author of the middle part of Job took that well-known story and used it as a starting point for a rich and meaningful exploration of how we can relate to God even when life is hard. And in spite of all our misunderstandings about the book of Job, it's still one that people of faith come back to again and again and again for hope and comfort in hard times. And that's because we all face dark, lonely chapters of life. I can imagine that some of us watching today have heard the story of Job, and then when we encountered our own Job chapters in life, times when everything seemed to be going wrong, we turned to this book and found someone who could identify with our suffering. We looked to Job for answers, especially the answer to the question, why do the righteous suffer? And that's the traditional question that people bring to the book of Job. That's the question that his friends are trying to answer for him all throughout these poetic chapters. Why do the righteous suffer? People suppose that since we get to see behind the curtain, since we get to see how God decided to let Satan wreak all kinds of havoc on Job's life, the book must have some kind of answer when we're wondering why God would let this pain happen to us in our lives too. And that's how we wish the book of Job worked. But we actually don't get to decide how it works. We don't get to decide what questions it answers. Instead, we have no choice but to sit back, take in the text on its own terms, and read it for what it's worth. And when we do that, here's what we get. Job's friends, who represent the popular view of Job's time, and in many ways ours, do good and God will reward you. Do bad and God will punish you. That's why they insist that Job must have done something wrong as he faces tragedy after tragedy after tragedy. They believe in a universe that works predictably, formulaically. They believe that good things happen to good people and bad things happen to bad people. It just makes sense when you think of a world that works that way. But our experience of the world looks a lot different than that. Job spends a lot of the book asking his friends for answers about why this suffering is happening to him, but they're no help. So at last, Job turns to God. Job says, "Where are you, God?" And remarkably, in a way that mostly only happens in literature, God shows up and gives this answer. In your lifetime, have you commanded the morning, informed the dawn of its place, so it would take hold of earth by its edges and shake the wicked out of it? Do you turn it over like clay for a seal so it stands out like a colorful garment? Light is withheld from the wicked, the uplifted arm broken. Have you gone to the sea's sources, walked in the chambers of the deep? Have death's gates been revealed to you? Can you see the gates of deep darkness? Have you surveyed earth's expanses? Tell me if you know everything about it. That's what God says to Job in his request for God to give answer for his pain. It seems like God has little interest in answering Job's nagging question about why this suffering has befallen him. Instead, God questions Job. He questions Job's right to ask questions like that. God lays it out for Job. Your human mind can't fathom this vast world I created and that I command even still. The logical step from here is to realize that if God's capacity for understanding is that much greater than our own, we probably can't grasp the reasons behind our suffering. And God goes on and on like this, asking question after question. Are you strong like me? Do you know about the ancient creatures of the deep? What do you have to say for yourself? And Job is left speechless. Job responds to God the only way he can, with humility. admitting that he had no business asking these questions because the answers would be too much for him anyway. And that is when Job gets restored. When he stops fighting with his friends and grasping at a big reason why behind his pain, God blesses Job with double the wealth he had before. Job doesn't rise from the ashes because of karma or because he turned his life around. In this later rendition of Job, he rises from the ashes when he lets go of his need to know all the reasons why. I'm going to share just a few of the lessons of Job, but I'd like to encourage you to read it for yourself. The first lesson from Job that I want to share is this. Easy answers will always let you down. And by easy answers, I don't mean first grade math homework. By easy answers, I mean that in the complexity of this life, we are faced with a remarkable variety of challenges. Intellectual, moral, spiritual, relational challenges of every kind that weave together to create this complicated life that we live. There are systems that want to tell you that somehow, if you just do this one more thing or these three steps, somehow all of this complexity will be simple. Just pray more. Just do yoga. Just go to the right church. And if the past year has taught us anything, it's that the world isn't comfortable with complex, nuanced answers. Right? After months and months of learning the complicated dance between community spread and the needs of society for schools and businesses, every single news report about COVID-19 still has someone in the comments posting, "Just open up schools," ignoring the complexity of the issue. Our brains just don't like complicated answers. And in my experience and in my reading of Job, life is never just anything. Answers worth having are rarely easy. The right choice is rarely obvious. You are not suffering today just because you sinned, though, I mean, that might be part of it. You aren't a mess just because of your parents, but that's probably part of it. There are some baseline standards of justice and truth, but we have to live in a real world where things rarely, if ever, work out in a simple, linear way. Another lesson from the book of Job is this. The best response to pain is faith. Now, I know that there are a lot of people that point to the existence of pain and suffering in the world as a reason to give up on God or religion entirely. And if that's you or someone you know, I'd love to have a conversation about that with you. Because the reality is that it's the existence of pain and loss that has led humanity through our search for spiritual truth throughout history. We don't wonder, what is God like? Because everything is going so great, we wonder, what is God like? So we can understand who it is we are leaning on during personal tragedy. So we can understand what might await us on the other side of this life. So we can understand what the good life looks like, because we know there's something better than the mess we find ourselves in at any particular moment. The best response to suffering is faith, because it's in faith that we lean into the pain and mystery. Asking, "Where are you, God?" is an act of faith. Screaming to the heavens, "God, why did you do this to me?" is an act of faith. Finding a community that will pray with you and pray for you is an act of faith. When life gets hard, it isn't time to cocoon yourself away and shield yourself from the rest of the world. It's time to lean into your faith and into the community of faith. Wherever you happen to be today, we at Roots and Branches are here for you. This is the place you can let your scars show, and where you can know your shame and pain will be met with grace and acceptance. Here's my last thought about Job. We don't have to settle for the story we've been given. We don't have to settle for the story we've been given. Someone in the ancient world heard this simple story of Job again and again and said to themselves, "This story isn't good enough and it isn't true enough. I don't believe in a God who makes us suffer for no good reason, but at the same time, I don't believe in a world where everything happens for some simple reason." either. The way they worked out their complex interplay between faith and fate resulted in chapter upon chapter of poetry and thought that has added to the collective wisdom of humanity for generations. That author wasn't satisfied with the story they were given, so they wrote a new one. And you can too. What story did you inherit? That you're no good? That you're dumb? And if you inherited a story of shame, it's time to write a new one that welcomes the deep and abiding truth that God's love put you here, and there's a reason for your life. There are also stories about our world that we inherit. There are stories like that racism ended in the 60s, that if you work hard, everything will turn out right in the end, and a lot of people discover these stories don't hold up. Some of those old stories turn out to be false over time. And for you, it might be time to write a new story. A story about how a community of faith can rise from the ashes and in how you can be redeemed from the depth of who you are. We can be redeemed out of a story that's a pandemic of political and racial and political unrest, and embrace a new story where God values every person and that every person is called to make God visible in this world. So you can start writing that new story today. Don't settle for easy answers. Lean on faith when life is hard and rewrite your story in the ways that you act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with